Hey guys, thanks for stopping by our YouTube channel, or if you're listening to this on the podcast, thank you so much for taking the time to listen as always. Now, we've got a really cool episode for you today, and I'm allowed to say that because the focus isn't me. We've got four property investors, all at different stages of their investing careers, but all with one great piece of advice to share with you. Now let's rewind a little bit. This podcast came to be off the back of an Instagram challenge that Victoria ran a few weeks ago. 7 days of property. She's done it a couple of times now, but this last one really seemed to grab people's attention, which was cool. And one of the days of that challenge was to share your best piece of advice. The whole point of this challenge is to bring people together and help them get to know each other, but it's also nice to get them to dig deep and to share something of value as well. So this day in particular really stood out to me. And there were a few people who shared advice that I thought, you know what, that is really valuable. I would like to get that in front of an even bigger audience than they were getting it in front of on Instagram. So I contacted them and said, guys, would you expand on this a little bit? Record us a short video and we'll pull them together into a compilation of some really strong advice. And that's exactly what we are sharing today. So we have got four different investors sharing four very different pieces of advice, but the nice thing is there's a sort of underlying theme that ties them all together, which is cool as well. So that's exactly what we have got for you. Each clip is less than 5 minutes, so it's going to be a relatively short episode, but listen, pay attention, take notes, and if you only do one thing off the back of this, take one piece of advice that you think is a good idea and go away and start implementing it immediately. I guarantee you all four of these will have a big impact on your career, but just start with one. Think about what is going to have the biggest impact for you and go away today, tomorrow, and start putting it into practice. So we're going to start off with a piece of advice from Roland, but I will leave it to him to introduce himself.
Hi everybody, I'm Roland Simons. I'm a property developer and I invest in areas local to where I live in South London. And I'm currently focused on building out a portfolio of fully owned boutique HMOs for professional tenants. So the topic that Mike and Victoria have asked me to discuss today is choosing your investment location and something that goes hand in hand with that, which is how to value your own time. So if you're starting out and you've already met some active investors or you've spent some time on social media following some property accounts, you'll certainly have come across some people who are investing quite far away from where they live. And you know, the reason that that tends to happen is that people will pick a strategy, let's say it's HMOs for example, and then they will look for a location where that works really well and it might not necessarily be where they live. There's nothing wrong with this. Lots of people are doing it and making it work really, really well. But there are some downsides that it's worth being aware of. So the main issue that people will find when they start distance investing is that they've underestimated the amount of time that it's going to take them to build and run their portfolio. So most of that's travel time. So traveling to go for viewings, traveling to do site visits during a refurb project, and then you know, once the property's up and running and tenanted, potentially, you know, visiting your lettings agent from time to time, doing some periodic inspections, just staying on top of stuff. All of this adds up, and you know, it's not necessarily time well spent, because when you're in your car or you're on a train, you know, you're probably not sourcing deals necessarily, you're not networking, you're not meeting potential investors. Or it's time away from your family, or time not spent doing your hobbies, other things that you love doing. So, you know, in the spirit of kind of thinking about how to look for the best financial returns from your deals, but also bake in this time value element to it, you know, you can add your time into your deal stacking process. So let's say you've got two deals side by side. One's a local project, and one is a distance opportunity. Add a line item into your stacking spreadsheet, which is the number of hours that each deal will take of your time, which you've got to be trying to be realistic about, and then an hourly rate that your time is worth, so pounds per hour that your time is worth, and that will introduce a new cost line item to both deals. And you know, if you put more time for the distance deal, then that will obviously reduce the returns relative to the local deal, and it may bring them closer in line. And it may be that the distance deal still stacks better, and that's the way to go for you. Now, the other way to do this is rather than saying choose your strategy, then choose your location, you just say, I'm going to invest locally. That's a rule for me. And I'm going to work out which strategies work best in my area, because it doesn't matter where you live, there will be a way to make money from property in your area. It's just a question of having enough knowledge of the different potential investment strategies and then figuring out which ones work in your area. But beyond the time savings, there's loads of other advantages to investing locally, I think. You know, the chief of which is the knowledge that you already have of your local area. So you know the sorts of people that live in your area. You know where the jobs are. You know where the important transport links are. You know which are the good areas, the bad areas, those in-between areas where you want to be closer to the good than the bad. That's all really helpful knowledge, really valuable. And if you go to a new area, you're probably going to have to develop that from scratch, and you might even make some mistakes whilst you're developing that knowledge. When you're local, you can build relationships with agents much more easily. You can just be much more in their face, much more of a constant presence, and it's less stressful being local. You know, if your builders need you at short notice to make a decision, you just pop over, have a chat, make a decision, job done. If it's long distance, you're probably going to be trying to do it over the phone or with a video call, and it's just never quite the same. So local investing, easier, less stressful, and frees up time. But if you still decide to distance invest, there is nothing wrong with it. Like I said earlier, you know, lots of people do it, lots of people are making it work. And what I'm talking about here is really just a thought experiment for you. Think about the pros and cons, the trade-offs involved, and ultimately the decision is yours based upon your objectives and your circumstances, really. And in the interest of balance, there are certainly pitfalls of local investing. You know, you can become way too hands-on in your portfolios and in your development projects. You know, I've even come across, you know, people with a couple of HMOs and they're doing their own cleaning and they're doing their own gardening, and you know, that's not a good use of their time either. So, you know, if you wouldn't be prepared to clean someone else's house for the hourly rate, you know, you shouldn't be cleaning your own. This is all about valuing your own time correctly. So that's all from me. I hope you found it useful. If you'd like to connect, look me up on Instagram, Roland Simons. My handle is @bricksanddaughters. I'm also on LinkedIn. Thanks very much for listening.
So that was a very balanced view from Roland, but I completely agree with the sentiment of investing on your doorstep wherever possible. Now, of course, your ideal investment strategy may not work in the area that you live, but personally, I would strongly suggest that in that case, rather than try to find an area where that perfect strategy works, you dig deep and think about what strategy is going to make the most sense in the area that you're already familiar with. I think that is going to yield better results than starting to spread your search further and further afield. Now, he's really covered the main points that I would have put forward for this argument. I think the idea of entering your time as a line on your deal analysis spreadsheet is a great one, but it's the second part of his argument that I most passionately agree with. Building a team of contractors that you can rely on, building relationships with all of the important people who are going to play a part in your success, planning consultants and estate agents and all of those different contacts that make up your power team, if you like using that term. And if you don't, well, give me a better suggestion. And knowing your area intimately, inside out, knowing which streets that you should avoid, knowing which property types in that area are suitable for loft conversions or where the sellers have usually got enough head height to do a conversion without massive expense, knowing where the young families who are priced out of the current hotspot are looking to next, knowing the areas that people visiting to visit friends and family, or from a corporate point of view, if they're looking for accommodation during the week, the areas that they want to stay in. All of this stuff is going to help you build up a better picture and become a better investor in your area. And it's going to be much easier to build up this knowledge, this repository of valuable information, if it's an area that you're already familiar with, because you live there, because it's on your doorstep, because you passionately are already invested in this area. One of the things I hear from a lot of aspiring investors is this idea of the grass is greener somewhere else. I'll get investors from Nottingham email me saying, oh, I'm looking to invest in Stockport because the Nottingham market's dead. And in the same week, I'll get emails from investors in Stockport saying, oh, Stockport doesn't work, I'm gonna go look in Nottingham. If you give me an area in the UK, I can give you a list of half a dozen or a dozen different investors who are currently making more money than you need to be financially free anywhere in the UK. So rather than thinking, well, where is this strategy going to work out the best, I really encourage you to think more about what is the best way I can make property investment work in the area that I already know and understand. If you're not entirely convinced on this approach yet, then I'd suggest you go and listen to a podcast that we recorded recently with Christina Castellina, who really puts this into practice in her own investment area. But before you head off to iTunes, let's take this next piece of advice from Ben Thorns.
Hello, I'm Ben from Living Smart. We are developers and investors based in South Manchester, carry out projects in the whole of the Northwest. We've got HMOs, we do commercial conversions, and we're on site at the moment with a new build development, a couple of houses really close to us in a nice little village called Lim. So we're looking to do more new build development, we're growing that part of the business, and as we do that, we're also increasing our portfolio as well. So we do a lot of sourcing, and we tend to do our sourcing in-house. We have quite a large funnel. We have leads that come in from different sources, from estate agents, commercial agents, but we definitely tend to find the best deals we do are off-market deals. And our top tip really for sourcing those deals is just to walk a different path. And I mean that quite literally. Never walk the same way home or to work or drive the same way. We always just try and find different streets that we've never been down. Just have an inquisitive nature. We got a really good deal by doing this, and it was in a town that I used to live in, I was visiting, and I could just walk down the main pedestrian street with everybody else, but I just have this mantra in my mind that I want to look, I want to see what's available, and I walked down a little back street, well, not necessarily a back street, but just a quieter street in the town, and you see the sailboat straight away, GVA, it was a block of three apartments done really, really nicely, but unfortunately the owner had got into financial difficulties, it was with the receivers. So just by spotting this and quickly calling, I got this picture that this was a really good deal. They needed somebody who could move quickly, we were that person. So we did, we moved really quickly on this deal. It's now in our portfolio. We've only got about £5,000 left in it. We needed minor cosmetic work. It was basically just bit of minor maintenance and decorating. It's just a great property, great project. And the only reason we found that was just by walking down a different street to what I would normally walk down. And we do this everywhere we go. If I go to the city centre, I'm driving my family mad, trying to take them different routes. But you do spot deals this way. There are deals everywhere. When you open your eyes to it and you keep on searching, looking under all those nooks and crannies, there's definitely gold out there. So that's definitely my top tip.
Now this is a great build on the previous piece of advice from Roland, but it is also applicable if you do decide to invest somewhere out with the area that you currently live in. I've had the pleasure of spending a lot of time with Ben and his brother Tom, and everywhere we go they are a walking encyclopedia of the ownership history and the planning history of pretty much every building that we walk past. After a Christmas night out last year, Tom gave me a guided tour of Manchester's northern quarter, who owned which buildings, what planning applications had been submitted, approved and refused, and the sites that they were keeping an eye on for their own portfolio as well. On another occasion, we had a walk through part of Stockport's town centre where we've both got investments, and again, the level of detail and knowledge that they both had on the entire area was just mind-blowing. They really embody the idea of getting to know the areas that you're investing in intimately, and at a high level, the payoffs are obvious. They're building out this visual map in their minds of where the investment is moving to, where other investors are moving into, where planning applications are being approved, and what development is in the pipeline so that they can start to spot opportunities before they become common knowledge. And at deal by deal basis, it's really helping them source each of their individual projects as well. They have found pieces of land whilst sitting on the tram, they've found great commercial conversions whilst visiting friends and family, and like Ben said, even just on walking a different route home from work every day. This is really one to think about if you are looking to extend your sourcing beyond what's available on the open market with estate agents, and the beauty of it is it's so easy to implement as well. Next up though, let's hear a piece of advice from Anthony, and this one is relevant to everyone, but particularly if you are just getting started out.
Hi everyone, Anthony Hunt here from Champ Properties. I'm an investor based in the northeast of England. We are collectors of buy-to-lets, hoarders of buy-to-lets, very notorious for trying to flip things and keeping them, but that's just the way we are. As a portfolio landlord, we have properties across Northumberland, West Newcastle, South Tyneside, and some in Scarborough, which is where we were originally brought up. So the context of this video I've been asked to do is based around something that I posted on social media last week. It was a bit of a ruler which had somebody at one end and somebody at the other, and it was just saying never really compare yourself to somebody else's journey, because you may be on different paths. So that's going to be the context of this video and I suppose my opinions on it. So when we first got into property, I did a lot of networking, as you would expect. We went to a lot of networking meetings. And one question I always used to fear was, how many properties have you got? I used to feel really awkward because I didn't want anybody to know at 22, 23 years old. For some reason, I didn't want anybody to know that we didn't have any properties and that we had no experience. And I found it a little bit embarrassing. The questions tended to be, hi, my name's Anthony, how many properties have you got? So it became a little bit of a thing which at meetings I used to worry about slightly. I think it's Tony Robbins that says money and or something like money is the only thing that can, when you haven't got it, you're embarrassed, and when you've got it, you can also feel embarrassed. So switching that round to now and its relevance, I don't like to discuss how many properties we've got because I find it a little bit embarrassing. So, and that isn't to say that we've got loads, and that isn't to say that we haven't got money. So for some people that are investing in property, they might have only been in it for a year and they'll have more properties than the rest of their family, which isn't a good thing or a bad thing. It's just the context of how it is. So the reason I want to talk about portfolio size and number of properties is because it's completely irrelevant. Some people might get into property, they might have a job that they absolutely love, and they might want one property that cash flows £250 a month because it pays for their holidays. Does that make them any more successful or any less successful than somebody who has 100 properties? In my opinion, absolutely not. If somebody that has 100 properties is doing it because they need to service a certain need or because they need to cash flow a certain amount of money a month and they aren't hitting that, then in my opinion, the person that's doing what they're doing with the one buy to let to pay the holiday a year is more successful because they're hitting the goals. So it's all subjective and it's all completely relevant in terms of what you're trying to achieve. So for us and our strategy, we love buy to let. We like the buy to let model. We were brought up around those sorts of properties and we've got a really good system in place and really good people around us. So it's a strategy that we absolutely love. A buy to let strategy does mean that you need to acquire more properties than maybe somebody who wants to be in a HMO strategy. Does that mean we're better investors? Does that mean we're more successful if somebody's got 20 and somebody's got 10? Absolutely not. It's all relevant. So I'm quite entrepreneurial and my brother's getting there with his entrepreneurial side. For me, the cash flow from the business and the cash flow from properties will allow one of two things, security. So as time goes on and the loan to values get better and the cash flow increases, etc., it seems like a really good thing for a retirement plan. It'll also give us a lot of cash flow in the meantime for living and having a good life, but it also allows us a lot of cash to put into other businesses and start up other ventures. That's just us. That's not something that is relevant for everybody. It's just the way that we've decided to kind of do what we're doing. So my advice, I suppose, would be to start with the end in mind. If you are getting into property, or if you're in property, if you don't know what the end looks like, how can you ever get there? So, I suppose that's my little nugget from this whole thing. Don't compare yourself to other people. Don't be worried about the question at the property meetings, as I was. I was taught what I used to say to people was a handful. And then some people that really want to know and really want to get nosy will say, well, how big is a handful? And as soon as you say it depends how big your hands are, it usually puts them off because they've realised that it's not a question that you want to answer. So don't focus on it too much. Focus on the end instead of those numbers and the minute details. But yeah, that's my take on things.
I think Anthony really sets it straight here with some solid advice on thinking about and doing what is right for you rather than what looks good to someone external. The size of your portfolio has very little bearing on your ultimate success, and whilst it's guaranteed that a larger portfolio, and whilst And whilst it's guaranteed that a larger portfolio will bring you more headaches and more administrative work, it does not guarantee that it's going to generate you more profits than a better run, smaller portfolio. If your end goal from property, if the whole reason you got into this was something simple like covering your mortgage payment every month or maybe generating enough money to pay for your kids' school fees, then when you hit that goal, don't think that you need to continue just for the sake of it. Obviously, your goals can change over time and what you want to achieve from property may continue to expand as your portfolio does grow. But just be mindful of why you got into this in the first place, what the reason is that you're doing this, and don't create a massive job and a massive headache for yourself just because you feel like you've got some momentum behind you and you should keep going. If you have hit your goals and your goals haven't changed, then please feel free to stop at that point. I think that as a whole, we need to stop focusing on how well other people are doing, or certainly how well they pretend to project that they're doing on social media and in YPN magazine, and instead just focus on what is important to us, what we need to achieve in order to achieve our own goals. And if someone really does force the issue with you, then just remind them that your handful of properties really depends on how big your hands are. Now, finally, we have got a piece of advice from Jade Bailey, one of our favourite property investors, and I'm sure you'll agree that this is a good one as well.
Hi, everybody from the Inside Property Investing community. I'm Jade Bailey, and I am from B-Space. I'm a female property developer. I'm from Nottingham, and I specialise in HMOs, I suppose, now. And I'm just about to go into serviced accommodation in quite a big way. About 2 weeks ago, we all took part on the Instagram challenge for Inside Property Investing for the 7 day, 7 days of property challenge. And I think around day five, one of the things we had to all post about was share your pearls of wisdom about being a property developer. Now, on reflection, what I posted was quite cryptic. So I said that if you share, opportunity will find you. So Mike and Victoria have asked me to expand on exactly what that means. So it's quite simple, really. I'll put it into context with how that's affected me. So when I first started to kind of get into self-educating how to do HMOs, couple of about 2.5-3 years ago, I was having a casual chat with a family member about what I was doing, what I planned to do, how I was going to raise the finance to be able to do it. And the family member offered to remortgage a house that had no mortgage on it, and then essentially became my first JV partner. Now that was just literally a conversation. She witnessed what I was doing and decided to, you know, invest in me and what I wanted to achieve. From that point, after I got those first houses, I then started going on to Instagram, and I never thought that there was a community for property developer type people on there. But there was, and I started to post and started to engage and make some friends and got a really good reaction to some of the images I was posting. And then Mike and Victoria asked me to go on the Inside Property Investing podcast. And kind of from that point, things really escalated for me. At that stage, I was just designing for myself. And then I went on to start to be approached by other investors that wanted me to design for them. So I've since built up my design business organically off the back of it, which is doing really well. And I'm really proud of what I've achieved within a year with that business. It's also enabled me by being on Instagram, being totally transparent and honest and authentic, to come into contact with my two other JV joint venture partners who I'm now doing two different strategies with. So that's essentially by talking about what I'm doing and showing what I'm doing and being authentic and being real. It's brought me three joint venture partners, which is amazing, because I think when you're kind of starting out, you can't even imagine how you would achieve that, where somebody would invest in you. But they can. But people need to see what you're up to. If you're going to get out there and you're going to share and you're going to show everybody what you're about, then it's really important that you're authentic and that you've got a consistent voice and message, and you know, you engage with people, because that's what social media is all about. And there's a massive benefit to it if you do it in an authentic manner. So that's a little bit about me. I love the Instagram community. We're such a friendly bunch. So if you're thinking about coming to join us, come and give me a hello. Thanks for having me on, Michael Victoria, much appreciated.
I really love this advice regardless of who gives it. But in this instance, it's great to hear it from Jade because she really put it into practice and saw the results that came off the back of it. A quick caveat, I suppose, before we dive into it is that keeping Anthony's advice in mind, if your goals are modest, if you don't need to build a large portfolio or a multifaceted property business, then putting yourself out there and creating this brand around yourself, around your business, probably isn't necessary. So don't feel like you need to do it just because you see other people doing it. However, if you do want to create something beyond just a simple property portfolio, then putting yourself out there in an authentic way and on a platform or a medium that ties in with how you operate. Don't put yourself on video if you don't like being in front of the camera. Do something different. Maybe audio works for you, or creating graphics, or just sharing images on Instagram. But do something that is authentic to you and that you feel comfortable with, and the results from it can be huge. Whether your focus is to raise finance for future projects, to find partners to work with, or to identify new business opportunities to take your business in new directions, then sharing your passion with the world is one of the best ways of achieving this. It has paid off massively for Jade, and this same approach has obviously paid off massively for myself and Victoria as well. Now, we also took part in the challenge and shared our advice along with everyone else. And the advice that Victoria shared was something that I really passionately believe in. It's a very simple three-word quote: done beats perfect. Something that we have realized and lived more and more over the past 10 years is the fact that momentum and speed with our investing has paid off a lot more than trying to be perfect. We see so many other investors that are keen to get going but always fail to get off the starting blocks because they think that that first deal that they're going to do needs to be perfect. And 2 years later, they are still looking for that perfect deal that just doesn't exist. I promise you that none of our deals, not a single one of them, has been perfect, but they have all been good enough. And we're now in a position where we have got a great portfolio of deals that are good enough. And from all the bits that weren't perfect, we learned a hell of a lot of knowledge from each of them as well. We're now lucky to be in a pretty comfortable position. But had we never got started because that first deal that we were looking for needed to be perfect, our lives sitting behind desks in the corporate world would have looked very different to how it looks now. So yes, be thorough in your due diligence and in your appraisal process. I'm not suggesting here that you take unreasonable risks, but as soon as you find that deal that is good enough, take action and get started, because if you don't start, you cannot win. So just keep in mind that in every aspect of your investing career, done beats perfect. Now, as I said at the start, my one piece of advice to you to wrap up this content is to take one of these that resonates with you the most and start putting it into practice today or tomorrow in your own property business, and the benefits should start to materialize quickly. If you want to find out about our next Instagram challenge, then it's simple. Just head over to Instagram and follow at Inside Property Investing. And I'm sure Victoria will be running one in the not too distant future where you can get started with your own Instagram account, meet other like-minded investors, and share some of your own advice as well. As well as that, I'd love it massively. I would appreciate it massively. I would just generally be extremely happy if you gave this video a big thumbs up. And if you want to see more content, more advice and inspiration about property investment in the UK, then subscribe to our channel as well. And we will see you in the next video.